When I first heard that Docker was working on something called Model Runner, my first reaction, honestly, was why? I mean, sure, you can already pull down a llama, grab some models, and then build an API layer on top of that. Or if you're not using containers, you're stuck using Python, CUDA, the right libraries, and a stack of dependencies, and hoping nothing conflicts. It's doable, but it's a lot of work. You end up spending more time wrestling with the setup than actually building anything. So at first I wasn't sure why we needed this, but then I tried it. I ran one command, hit enter, and suddenly I had a model up and running and ready to go. No setup headaches, no dependency juggling, just one command and done. And then when I saw it integrates directly into Docker Compose, that's when it really clicked. Before we dive deeper, a quick note, this video is sponsored by Docker. A big thanks to them for supporting the channel and for making this walkthrough possible. And just so you know, I've been playing with the Model Runner over the last few weeks and I'm super excited to share it with you. In this video, I'll cover the basics of getting started, show you how to use it with existing applications in Docker Compose, and then we'll wrap up with how I integrated it into a custom app I built, one you can even run on your own machine today. So what exactly is the Docker Model Runner? Think of it like a standardized way to run AI models using Docker. Now, normally when you want to work with an AI model, you've got to figure out the framework it's built on, the version of Python or CUDA it needs, and how to wrap it into something you can actually use within an app. With Model Runner, all of that complexity is packaged inside of the container image. That means instead of juggling dependencies, you just pull down a model and it runs consistently, whether it's on your laptop, your teammate's laptop, or in production. And one of the biggest benefits I think is that it bridges the gap between trying out a model and actually integrating it into your application, all without the glue code and setup in between. And stick around because I'll show you exactly how you can try this out yourself so it's not just theory. You'll be able to run the same demos on your own machine. So let's get started with the basics. If you're on Docker desktop, chances are you already have what you need installed today. Model Runner makes it easy to pull models just like pulling Docker images, but with the bonus of lower latency since they all run locally. So there's only one new keyword you need to know, and it's model. If you don't see this command working yet, make sure you've got the latest Docker desktop installed. Then head into settings and enable the Docker model feature. Once that's on, you can use the new commands. Pulling a model works just like pulling an image, but you use the new model keyword. For example, if you wanted to try out OpenAI's new OpenWeight model, you can run docker model pull AI GPT OSS, and that command would pull the model. If you wanted something a little bit smaller, like Llama 3.2, you could do docker model pull AI Llama 3.2, and that would pull down the model. And then if you run docker model lists, you can see all of the models you've pulled down locally. You don't even have to pull the model first. You can run it directly, just like a Docker image, and Docker will pull it for you. So if you run docker model run AI GPT OSS, this will pull the model if needed, and once it's ready, you're dropped into a CLI where you can start chatting with the model right away. If you want to run another model, just exit the CLI and run the command again with a different model name. You might notice that the first request takes a moment as the model loads into memory, but after that, it's really fast. And if you're not a CLI person, no worries, this all works inside of the Docker desktop app too. There's a model section where you can pull and run models with just a couple of clicks, and you can even chat with the model right away within the app. Now let's talk about running models right alongside your existing applications with Docker Compose. Anywhere you can run Docker Compose, you could run models too. Now here's a real-world example of using OpenWebUI as the front end and Docker Model Runner as the model service. Now notice the provider type, model. That's the key piece here, and one other key piece is that the app points to the model runner docker.internal so it can talk to the model locally. Run Docker Compose up and both services start together. OpenWebUI on port 3000 and the model served by Docker Model Runner. OpenWebUI uses standard OpenAI API calls, so swapping models later is just a one-line change under the model options.
Hey, it looks like OpenWebUI is now up and running. Let's check on localhost port 3000. So if we go there, we can see OpenWebUI is up and running. I've already created an account, but if you need to create one, you would do so here. Then you'll be dropped into a typical chat interface you see with OpenWebUI. Another cool thing is it's able to discover those models that are local on our machine for Docker Model Runner, and you can switch between them. Let's try something, plan a trip to the moon. And there it goes. It was already loaded into memory. It doesn't need to load a second copy, so it was pretty quick. So let's switch then to one of the thinking models just to make sure it can handle that. Plan a trip to Jupiter this time. This one's a little bit larger and it wasn't loaded into memory for me, so there we go. And you can see it's handling a thinking model just fine. We could see it's thinking right now. We could see its thought process. It's going through that and it's running relatively fast for being on my machine and running locally. So pretty cool. We can get this running in Docker Compose. As you can see, all I did was define this service, add the provider of type model, and then give it some options of my model type, which is this one right here. So pretty easy to do.
So the takeaway here is pretty simple. Treat the model runner just like another service in your Docker Compose file. Start it, stop it. It's the same workflow you already know. But how do I build it into my own custom application? Glad you asked, because next I'll show you how I wired this into a custom app so you can build features on top of it.
So here is the chatbot that I built. It's the world's most mediocre AI chat interface. It's not the greatest, but you'll see. But it's built on top of Next.js using TypeScript, Tailwind for CSS, of course using Docker, but it could use any OpenAI compatible endpoint, and then using React and a couple other things that I use a lot during my day job. And it supports a couple of things, light mode, dark mode, but rather than tell you about this application, let's just spin it up really quick. So first you want to clone this repo and then you open it up. And then the first thing you'll need to do is run yarn to install some dependencies and then you're ready to go. So a quick tour of the application within app, you're going to see my API endpoints. So I have one for the actual chat endpoint and then one for model info. And that's really just to grab the model that we're using along with the API endpoints so they can be configured server side and then delivered to the client. And then if we look at chat, this is actually the chat that's going to be happening. So we have the chat handler. So anytime we chat, it's going to send messages into here. And then from here, it's going to send it to Docker Model Runner, you know, pass it to the Model Runner API. It will return that data back to my server, which is Node.js, and then it will return it back to the client. So pretty typical Next.js application. It only has these two routes. And then I have some components. So these are React components. So I kind of broke these up. I went a little overboard. I started with a really simple chat application and it just kept growing and growing. A lot of scope creep here. I even wrote tests for this in mocks. So if you want to get started with React or Next.js or even Tailwind or Docker or any of this stuff, this is a great repo to learn all of that at once, especially hooking in Docker Model Runner, because you don't need to do anything else. You just run Model Runner and you don't have to worry about getting your models from anywhere else. So a lot of applications in here. I won't go into contacts and hooks. Those are pretty advanced stuff. But if we go into our package.json, you'll see scripts here, and these are scripts used to do different things in the application. And the one we want to run is yarn dev. And so what that's going to do is spin up the application. A really quick tour of my .env really quick. My .env file is for local environment variables. So when this application spins up, it needs some environment variables and I define them inside of my env.local. Now you won't have one of these, you'll have an env.example. And what you'll wanna do is just copy this, paste it in here and rename it to env.local. And most of these defaults are going to work, but the example one is just kind of, you know, telling people what they can do and how they can use it. And then you can customize this to yourself. So for example, if you wanted your chatbot to, you know, have a different personality or do something different or give it a different context, you would do so here. And so you can specify in this variable what you want, your preference. And so I have some pretty decent defaults set up and you'll see them. The last thing I'll call out is this LLM base API URL. And this is really where the URL is that's hosting our LLMs. And so when I develop locally, it's going to be on localhost 12434. We saw that earlier within the Docker application, we opened that port up and we said it's on 12434. And so that's why I'm using it here. If you remember in our Docker container earlier or in Compose, we used something different. And so if you're running inside of a container, you'll use this URL right here. But we're not going to be running this application inside of a container. It's going to be running on our local machine. And so when you run it on your local machine or in production or somewhere else, you're going to have to actually use an IP address and possibly DNS. So anyways, so let's start this up. I would start with a yarn dev that will spin up this application. Here in a couple of seconds, we'll see that the application is running, and it already is running. Here we go. So here's the chatbot. If you've already loaded that LLM into memory, this will go fairly quickly. If not, you might have to wait a few seconds. But you can see if I refresh it, it's loading pretty quickly, and it's saying, hello, I'm your mediocre AI assistant, because it's pretty mediocre. And so let me actually hide this next debugging really quick. So I'm going to say, let's plan a trip to Neptune this time. And we can see I sent the message. It is thinking right now. And the way that I have this set up is it's not going to reply with a streaming, you know, chat as you would typically see on a lot of the chat interfaces. I just send it all back at once. So it might take some time because it's actually using the thinking model. But after that, we'll be able to see what it thought along with, hopefully, a planned trip to Neptune. But if you want to add a streaming feature to this, feel free to open a pull request and do that. It's open source. It's on GitHub. And here we go. It responded back. It responded back a lot, and it took a lot to think. So let's scroll up and let's see here. You can see that this is the thinking model, and I built this feature so you can actually see what the model was thinking. You can see here the user said, let's plan a trip to Neptune. Probably they want a trip planned to Neptune, or maybe they meant let's plan a trip to Neptune. Neptune is a planet, not habitable. So maybe they want a hypothetical trip, and you can kind of see, you know, what this LLM was, you know, quote unquote, thinking as it processed this message. And then so when it responded back, you know, here's the response and typical things you would see. I got Markdown working within my application too. So pretty cool. And how do we know that that went to, you know, the Docker model runner? Well, if we go back to the Docker model runner within Docker desktop and we go to models and I'll choose the GPT OSS, so the open source GPT one, and I go into requests, I guess I didn't need to choose it. But if I go into requests, you'll see here that we actually see the request coming in and the prompt was, let's plan a trip to Neptune. So if we click on this prompt, we get a lot more information about what happened. So, you know, was it a success or not? You know, what was the response? What was the length? How many tokens per second it took? How many tokens were sent as the prompt? And then if we look at view request, we can see the JSON here. So here's the model that I sent in, AI GPT OSS. Then it had a message key and that's an array. So there were two messages in there. One is to the system and it says, you are a helpful AI assistant. So this was my prompt. And then the role, user, me, and I said, let's plan a trip to Neptune. Set a max tokens, temperature, stream falls. This is all configurable too within the variables that we saw a little bit earlier. And then it will show the response along with a lot more information. And so we see tons of stuff about this coming back, timings, prompt in milliseconds, even the ID for this chat. So a lot of cool stuff that we see right here that would otherwise be a little bit harder to see. Of course, we can get it back if we had some debugging information we set up within my application, but it's nice to see right here, you know, and kind of get a lot of this information, you know, in this nice UI. Logs too, you'll see logs. So here's everything that it was doing, just as I would have if I were running any other model runner. So pretty cool. Like I said, we could change this model if we wanted. We could change the URL. So if we were ready to go to production and we didn't want to use the model runner locally, you know, you would configure your production URL here, run it and run it against that. So you don't have to waste tokens or expensive tokens on other, you know, AI systems while you're developing your application. You can actually do it pretty cheap with local models first. And then one more thing I will show, just like we saw earlier, the compose file. And so the compose file for this is really going to be building this application each time we run our compose file. You can see I have this Docker file here and it's a multi-stage Docker file. That's not really that important, but it is highly optimized for production. But if we look in here inside of my compose file, you know, same kind of thing. I have one service running, which is this techno-boto-chat. It's going to be hosted on port 3000. Then all of my environment variables. And remember, you know, now when we're running this compose stack, we're inside of a container. So I need to refer to it on this internal DNS name that Docker knows, which is modelrunner.docker.internal. And then the path to it is /engine /v1. And then the rest of the stuff looks pretty much the same, a volume that I don't really need. What it depends on, so it depends on the model runner. And if you see, it looks exactly like what we had before. Docker model runner, that's the name of the service. You can name it anything you'd like. And then we have the provider of type model, and then the options model key is set to this model right here. And so let's run this really quick. Let's kill the application we have running down there. And then I'll do a docker compose up dash dash build dash force recreates dash no dependencies. So I want to make sure that this is building fresh every time. Typically I wouldn't do that, but for this demo, I want to make sure it's doing everything fresh. So it's going to go through, it's going to build that application. It's going to start that application up. And so now we should have this running on port 3000 again, but it's coming from that container and it's coming from compose rather than our local development environment. So if we go back to our chat and we do some refreshing, you could see here that now it's coming from here. It's coming from, you know, our model runner docker.internal. And so that's another reason why I kind of put this up here, so I knew which endpoint we were hitting and which model we were using. Then I mean light mode, brace yourself. Then we have light mode too, but it defaults to dark. So pretty cool, pretty real world example of something you can pull down and tie into Docker Model Runner and start running it today.
So that's Docker Model Runner, a way to go from models to working apps with almost no setup. So whether you're running it from the CLI or wiring it into Docker Compose or developing against it locally, it really simplifies the whole process of getting models into your workflow. And if you want to try it yourself, I'll have links in the description, and definitely give my chat app a spin if you want a ready-to-go example. Big thanks to Docker again for sponsoring this video. I'm Tim. Thanks for watching.